Hey everybody, welcome back to video 5 in my 10-part series. In this video, we're going to talk about media reactors and filtration. And for those of you who've been watching, you can probably see that I got a absolutely stunningly gorgeous frog spawn coral right there in the middle. So yeah, it is so captivating, I just can't take my eyes off it. Anyway, that's not why I'm here. I'm here to talk about media reactors and filtration. So please subscribe, please like, please ask any questions. And again, this is just kind of a general overview of things I wish I knew when I was starting out in the hobby. And it's meant as a good foundation that you can then go and research kind of on your own. Okay, we're going to talk about filtration first. Three types of filtration: mechanical, chemical, and biological filtration. Pretty simple to understand, but there's a little bit of overlap that was a little confusing when I started out. So let's talk about it. Biological filtration. I'm going to focus on this more in video 7, but basically it is the process of using like biological masses of like microscopic organisms to turn chemicals, things like ammonia, which are really, really bad to your livestock. And it's the process of using those organisms to eat and to consume the ammonia and to turn it into less dangerous chemicals that can be removed from your tank. An example of a biological process like this would be just how yeast turns sugar into alcohol. So a really easy way of understanding that. So we are trying to cultivate good bacteria to consume the bad things and to turn them into something less dangerous to our livestock. But again, I'm gonna talk about that more a little bit later. Mechanical filtration, pretty easy to understand. Mechanical filtration is basically the process of removing solids from the water, like uneaten foods, fish waste, stuff like that, solids. You know, the easiest way to think about mechanical filtration is with like a sponge. So just picture a sponge, right? And this sponge, you can kind of see, very porous. Water passes through, but big stuff doesn't. So if you just left the sponge in your aquarium forever, it would not help at all. But if you remove it on a consistent basis and rinse those solids away, then you're mechanically filtering. So it works pretty easy. In an aquarium, it is best to remove as much physical matter as possible using a sponge, using something else, before it breaks down into things like phosphates and ammonia. So fish waste and food, if it is not removed via some sort of mechanical filtration, it will break down and turn into things like ammonias and phosphates, which are not good for your tank. So you want to remove them as much as possible. So examples of mechanical filtration: filter sock, very, very common. People will use them, people don't use them. I run my system without a filter sock. But I use a filter sock whenever I do a cleaning because I want to catch everything and then I remove it. Really simple, it's just a mesh bag, right? And you have to replace them every few days because, like I said, this will catch a lot of physical matter, but if it's just left in your water, it will break down. So you should have several of these, use them, replace them frequently, wash them. Yeah, so that is one. Second mechanical filtration method is obviously your sponge. You know, filter sock's gonna catch a lot more than a sponge, but a sponge I often use in between, well, I'll show you, but I use a sponge to help keep small bubbles out of my display tank. And the last method, of course, is, I'm gonna take this off here so you can see. The last method, of course, is your protein skimmer. So there's your protein skimmer. You can see kind of all the gunk. Really simple to understand. This tank right here, this pump, takes the water, collects water from here, up through the tubing, into here. Bubbles are formed in the bubble chamber, and protein or organic matter, like poop, like old food, is attracted to the bubbles. They stick to the top of the bubbles, and they eventually rise and are collected in the collection container. Now, when I was talking about that sponge before, my filter sock would go right there, right? But I'm not using a filter sock right now. But if you can see, the sponge right in between there. And that really is just a space to remove any solids, any remaining solids before the return pump, which you can see. And it also helps reduce all these microbubbles that are produced from your protein skimmer. So that is mechanical filtration, of which the backbone of this hobby is definitely the protein skimmer. Okay, next up is chemical filtration. Chemical filtration is basically the process, it's basically the process of using chemical compounds like activated carbon, GFO, which is of course granular ferric oxide we'll talk about, and it uses those to remove unwanted things like metals, heavy metals that are just in your water, bad smells, and phosphate. All right, so we're going to talk about a few of them, the first of which is activated carbon. Okay, here's my activated carbon. You can kind of see here. All right, I use this kind of high quality ROX 0.8. There are different kind of carbons out there, right? But basically activated carbon does a few things. It removes metals and smells. It makes the water clear and fresh smelling, which is always very nice. Like I said, there are different types. This is the kind of the high quality that BRS makes. Works fantastic to just make super clear water, which you can see from what I have. And you can use them either in a reactor, which we're going to talk about, or in a mesh bag, right? So there's a mesh bag. Comes a little tie. You just tie it, put it in there, squeeze it tight, and there you go. Okay, but we'll talk about how that works a little bit more later. Another example of chemical filtration is GFO, right? Here is GFO, granular ferric oxide. Okay, it's brown in color here. And what this does is you, again, can use it in a reactor, which we'll talk about, or in a mesh bag, and it removes phosphates from the water. Basically what it does. So. Usually lasts longer than carbon, so you don't have to replace it as frequently. Another kind of chemical filtration, I say it's chemical filtration, it's actually biological filtration, but I'm going to talk about it here anyways because it goes in a reactor, and those are biopellets. I don't have an example because I don't use biopellets, but biopellets basically are these little white circles, right? And you put them in a reactor, you know, which tumbles them, which we'll talk about here in a little bit. And the theory behind it is it provides a source of carbon for denitrifying bacteria. So basically what you're doing is you're giving these good bacteria food in the form of carbon. And what that's allowing them to do is it's allowing them to grow and grow and grow. When they grow, they're going to consume nitrate. And then what happens is they consume so much nitrate that they get big enough that they can be removed by your protein skimmer. All right, that's basically how it works. Biopellets, again, not really chemical filtration so much, more biological, but they also help remove phosphates, which is awesome. Kind of filtration doesn't fit into any of these is called a UV sterilizer. I don't use one. I don't see really a need for one in my system, but a UV sterilizer uses ultraviolet rays, you know, light basically. And you basically put it right before your return pump. And what it does is it stops certain microorganisms, like bad bacteria, algae, parasites. And it stops them from being able to reproduce, which in essence kills them. You can learn a lot more about them, but that's kind of about all I'm going to say. I don't use one, like I said, but a lot of people do use them effectively. You have to be careful because that UV light can be very, very bad for you if you're exposed to that. So just be really careful with that. All right, next up, we're going to talk about media reactors and mesh bags, all right? So, like I said before, mesh bags, right, really well used for things like carbon, activated carbon, and GFO, okay? They are inexpensive. You just put basically, you know, the carbon or the GFO or a mix of two into this bag, and you tie it off. You know, using the rope right here, and you place it in your sump or in another area in your tank that has a lot of high water flow. And basically you want water to pass through the mesh and it will come in contact with your carbon in your GFO, thus, you know, being effective. Okay, basically what it is, it's not as effective as a reactor, but it works, and it's certainly cheaper. Okay, I'm going to now take this down so we can go and talk about media reactors. So, media reactors. I have two media reactors down here in my sump, right? Basically, I was so confused by reactors at the beginning. All a reactor is, right, it is a canister. Okay, so if you look here, it's just a canister, all right? It is a canister in which you place your media being your GFO, your carbon, your biopellets, right? And then you attach a small pump, okay? So this one right here, there's a pump down below. You can see it. Okay, you attach a small pump to it, and all it does is it takes water, it pumps it in, and it runs it by your media, and then out again. Right? That's pretty much all a media reactor is. Okay, but there's different kinds. So I'm going to show you two kinds that I have. Okay, so one for GFO and biopellets. It could be either one of these, but this is for my GFO. And something to consider here is if you're doing GFO and biopellets, and you're not going to be able to see it very well, I'll turn it up here for you. You want to tumble it. I don't know if you can see that, but yeah, you can see it right there. But my GFO inside there is tumbling, meaning water is making it move around. That's awesome for a few reasons. It's going to make sure the GFO doesn't stick together. And it's also going to make sure that the water comes in contact with all the GFO. You can do this with GFO because GFO is hard. You do not want to do this with activated carbon. Activated carbon is in my back pump right there. Because if you tumble activated carbon, something bad happens. But in order to tumble it, you need to install a ball valve. So here's my ball valve, and this I can control how much water is coming in. So if you watch here, okay, if I turn it up, you're gonna see what happens. Okay, I get a lot more water movement. Okay, that's gonna be too much, and it's gonna grind down. It's gonna grind everything down. So I wanna turn it down so that it's just the top of it is turning over a little bit. All right, very easy. Sorry, that's not the best image. Okay, but that's basically all you need to do is you need to install a ball valve to control the flow. All right, pretty simple there. A carbon reactor, you can use this for a carbon reactor, absolutely, but then you just want to make sure that you take this sponge and you move it all the way down so that the carbon can't move, right? Because if the carbon does move, it is going to grind into a pulp and all the dusty fines are going to be let into your tank. So here's my right down here, really simple again, right? I just have, if you look down there, I have a just a small little pump running up into here. Okay, and then in it, I just have some carbon. It's not tumbling, as you can see, and it comes out through there. I replace my carbon every other week, and my GFO, I'm gonna wait and see, but I'll probably replace it every other week as well. The last option you can do is you can combine carbon and GFO into one, but if you do that, you wanna make sure you're not tumbling it, so you wanna definitely move the sponge all the way down. That's something that works. There are pros and cons to doing it that way, which I won't talk about right now, but you can do that for a cheaper option. And lastly, for a media reactor, here, let me put this right back up here real quick so that you can watch the tank and not the jerky motions from what I'm doing here. There we are. Ooh, it turned very blue. Lastly, there's something called two more things, sorry. A Kalkwasser reactor. I'm not going to talk a lot about Kalkwasser until a later video, but basically, a Kalkwasser reactor is the same as the reactors I showed you, except on the bottom there is something that's going to spin to keep the Kalkwasser moving, or else it will just solidify into something solid. So you do have to buy a separate reactor for that. So I'm not going to talk too much about that. But lastly is the calcium reactor. I don't have a calcium reactor, but let me tell you what it does, and it is a different kind of reactor, okay? The basic concept's the same. The container is full of aragonite, which is basically old coral skeletons of old dead coral, right? They crush it up, it's in big pieces. And then water is passed through it, just like in any other media reactor, but also pressurized CO2, so you have to have a CO2 tank. It's pumped over the aragonite as well. And what happens is the CO2 makes the water inside the reactor slightly acidic, which in turn then dissolves the old coral skeleton, and thus it adds calcium to your tank for the corals to use. A really highly effective way of dosing calcium to your tank if you have a large system. I do not require that, but I will talk more about two-part dosing at a later time. Anyway, that's it for video number 5. I hope you found it enlightening and useful. Please let me know if you have any questions. Please tune in for our next video, video 6. It's going to be sumps, refugiums, hang on the back, and maybe talking about some canister filtering as well. Anyway, thanks a lot, everybody. Hope you have a great day.